Hello everyone and welcome to Tuesday. First things first, wanted to give a little update on him. As you may recall, I think it was yesterday's vlog, we discovered that he had chewed through a bag of food and gorged himself. And the more impressive part of that was that he did it first by opening the door to the guest room. Now, I was concerned on two fronts. First front, that, having eaten all that food, nearly half a pound of food, that he may have some stomach issues, which might lead to, some bowel troubles. Happy to report that he has not, which I guess further concretes my idea that Kep really does have an iron stomach. I've thought that for many years, and it seems to be true. The second concern was that the bag was kind of a metallic foil, and I was like, not exactly sure how that's going to work. I really suspected that he was going to throw it up, but we went all day yesterday and he never did. Well, today he was upstairs with me and he started coughing a little bit. And the first thing I do, I don't know if other cat owners or pet owners do this, but the first thing I do, if I know this Kep is starting to puke and it's on carpet, is I go pick him up. Because once he starts coughing, you've got probably about 10 to 20 seconds to move him. And it's way easier to clean vomit up off of like wood or tile than carpet. So as soon as he started coughing, I moved him into the bathroom upstairs because there was tile. And sure enough, he had a big hairball, but right in the center was that the metal part of that bag. So he got it up. And I'm sure now he probably feels a little bit better. And, that bag's not in there anymore because we emptied it all into his food bin. But in the future, we're going to have to put the food that we get someplace else. Because whether by choice or by accident, he managed to open that guest room door and he found the food and he gorged himself. So we want to avoid that in the future, if possible. Today was a great day. We did breakfast stream this morning, of course. And then it was time for another First 20 stream, which means I'm going to be doing another little vlog review of the games that we played. So this is the games I played in September 2020. Let's talk about them. Did four games for First 20. I really needed to do six, ideally, but I thought six would be a stretch, and it definitely was because a lot of the games ran long today. Six would have taken me to the end of October, which would be ideal because that would get us through Extra Life, so I wouldn't have to think about it. But we couldn't do that many, so I did four. First game was DevKey, Surgeon Simulator 2. Now, the whole thing about Surgeon Simulator 2 is they're really pushing a co-op aspect. You can do all of the missions in the game with up to four people, and they would really prefer that you do that. But I couldn't do that today, so obviously it was just me. Still fun, still wacky. The big thing from the first game was that you were controlling the hands and didn't have very good mobility. It was kind of like Quap, that old Flash game, but with your hands. This time, you can actually move around in 3D space, and you'll be navigating parts of the hospital in order to grab different things. It makes a lot of sense to have four different people, four different surgeons on board for that, because you're going to probably be each taking on different roles. I compared it a little bit to Overcooked, but probably a lot more absurd. At some point in the future, I would love to try and play a little bit of it with some other people because I'm sure that it would be a pretty different experience than solo play. But even so, I still had a lot of fun and wacky adventures just doing the first 20 by myself. So there also seems to be some sort of level editor, it looks like. So there might be some like mission thing that you can make or even make your own levels or something. I didn't dive into that, but it looked like there was some sort of structure for that. So that's neat. It looks like honestly, building upon the original in a good way. It seems like it was a worthy sequel. Next up, I finally, after all these years, got the chance to play Yakuza. Yuki Mizuno sent me a Steam copy of Yakuza 0. There's a ton of Yakuza titles. They've been around for a long time. But from what I understand, Yakuza 0 is the place to start, both chronologically and also because apparently it's like one of the better ones or best ones in the series, although I guess that might be subjective. I'd always heard it compared to Grand Theft Auto. Like, Grand Theft Auto, but in Japan. But that's really not a good comparison. It's much closer to Shenmue. Although where Shenmue has some of this, like, let's say, weird, wacky stuff, it seems like Yakuza has a lot more cool, wacky stuff. It's kind of hard to explain. It has a really interesting, like, B-movie feel to it, and it takes itself not too seriously, but seriously enough. There's a lot of cutscenes, and it's about, I mean, obviously, the Yakuza, the Japanese mafia. I found the story very engrossing, actually. We ended up playing it for over an hour just because I was really, really into it. It's a game that I don't think I would bring to the channel. I don't think I would stream it, but at some point, if I had time, in my personal time, I'd probably play through it just to see what it was all about. I think it's definitely going to be for a certain person. I think that they'll catch that and they'll, you know, the style of gameplay that Grand Theft Auto is never appealed to certain people. They might go for Yakuza, which focuses more on the story, but again, doesn't take itself super seriously all the time, which I think is an admirable trait for a game like that. Next up on the list, courtesy of Curb, was Spiritfarer. Now, this is a fairly new title. This came out in late August, and I didn't really know a whole lot about Spiritfarer. I just knew that it had something to do with you had this magical boat, and you took folks who had died, and before they could fully pass on, you had to, like, do their last request for them before they could be at peace and move on to the afterlife. That's the premise. It's a very emotional game, a very, like, wholesome game, and that's kind of all I knew going into it. Now, we did the first 20, and I probably played nearly an hour of it, and I got a chance to see a lot of the game, but I didn't get to any of the stuff where you're, you know, doing the final request, where you're sending folks away. There's actually, because you're sailing on the sea, even though everything is presented in a 2D format, there is a map that shows you where you're going, and in many ways it felt a little bit like sailing in Wind Waker to me, which was a plus. The game overall is super casual, which is nice. It has a nice flow to it. The dialogue is exceptionally well written, and it's sweet, but also I started to get some undertones of some more serious stuff that may possibly be discussed in the course of the game. So I would imagine that there might be some heavy themes at times in the game, but certainly nothing to its detriment, only to its praise. There's a lot of customization on the boat itself. There's not a whole lot to do on the boat. A lot of the game seems really focused on the story and interacting with the characters. So in the early game, where they're kind of teaching you the ropes, a lot of what you're doing while you're waiting for the ship to sail from point A to point B is to just fish off the back of the boat, which, you know, is fine, but mechanically it's kind of the same thing every time, and there didn't seem to be a whole lot of variety in what I was catching, at least in the early game. Overall, I think that a lot of people would really, really like it, especially because, you know, in 2020, I think wholesome games are a must in some degree. So if you're looking for something like that, Spiritfarer may be something you should consider, or, you know, at the very least, watch the first 20 and decide for yourself. The very last game that I played today came to me courtesy of Jam, and it was CrossCode. This is a game that was in development for a long, long time, actually released on PC, Mac, and Linux in 2018, and just this summer came to consoles, Switch, Xbox One, and PS4. It's really, really good. It is an action RPG with a really strong pixel art style, and the entire game was created in HTML5, which is just this really neat tidbit. Like, it doesn't have any effect on the game itself, but it's just really cool knowing that it was. The game plays really, really well. Like, it's a very, very strong action RPG. It's also hard to explain from, like, the control side, but it controls very smoothly. I don't know if that's going to come across in the video itself, but, like, it's just fun to play. It feels good in your hands. It feels good to play. And I played a lot of that, much more than I certainly needed to. But it's just, there was a really, really long tutorial section. It was kind of broken up into multiple mini tutorials, such in a way that it didn't feel overtly like a tutorial section, and they just kept opening up more and more of the game. But really cool, like the from a story perspective, it was really cool. From a gameplay perspective, it was really strong. And then there's all these puzzles that are actually strewn throughout the dungeons, and they're good. They're not just thrown in there to be in there. Like, they're well thought out. All in all, you can tell that the game had been polished to a very bright shine. Like, this is a game that's been in development for a long, 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 long time, and I think it paid off in this particular circumstance. I played it on PC, but I think it would be a really good game for Switch, to be honest. Something to play on the go. Maybe it's just something about it that reminds me of playing like an old handheld game, like Golden Sun or something, that makes me want to play it handheld on the Switch, but it was really cool. And that was the four games I played. Again, as I said at the beginning, I played them much longer than I thought I would. I played Yakuza, Spiritfarer, and CrossCode all for over an hour, or nearly over an hour each, and it's just that they were really fun games. Obviously all very different, including Surgeon Simulator, but truly in the first 20 stream, I felt like to some degree there was something for everyone. And while I didn't get all six videos done, I got four done, and I'll just revisit first 20 stream in the middle of October, and then, you know, do at least two, and then I'll be set for Extra Life, which is awesome. Tomorrow, I'm going to be working on Mario and trying to get some of that done as well. So, yeah, just trying to push ahead a little bit since Extra Life is upon us. October 24th will be here before I know it. The other thing that I did upstairs as a part of doing the first 20 stream is I've been rewiring a lot of things because I now have the two desks, and it's not perfect yet. It's not exactly how I want it, but it's getting there. And hopefully over the course of the next few streams, I'll have things exactly as I want them. Hopefully. Anyway, that is it for today. Thank you so much for watching. If you joined me for the stream this afternoon, I really appreciate it. First 20 streams only happen once a month, but they're always a joy. And it's fun to share all of the experiences of me playing a game for the first time with a live audience. It's a very different feel from how I used to do it. And, you know, if you missed this one, the VOD is on Twitch, so you can watch it there. Or, of course, these videos will be coming out every Friday for the next 4 weeks on Steven Plays. And we'll be doing another one at some point in mid-October. Thanks for watching. And as always, let's meet back tomorrow, shall we?